Does this microphone? Yeah, it suddenly works, doesn't it? Okay, hi everyone. My name is Konrad Talmont-Kaminski, and as the title on the box says, I'll be talking about cognition and the science-religion debate. In other words, I'll be trying to talk about what cognitive science of religion, and actually cognitive science of science, tells us about how we should understand the differences between science and religion. So we start off with the question, what is the difference between science and religion? And my original background is actually in philosophy. And you've probably heard the saying that if you ask a philosopher a question, by the time that they're answering a question, you will not actually understand what your question was. So I will start off by saying that, well, actually, there's a problem with the way that this question is asked, because it makes a number of assumptions. Right? The first one is that there is a difference, a difference. Whereas in fact, what a lot of people who actually look at this stuff will say is that there's a whole bunch of different differences, which are all connected with each other, and you cannot just simplify in terms of a single difference. To make the picture even more complex, it's not a difference between science and religion, it's a difference between science and religions, plural. Right? If you ask most cognitive scientists of religion, they'll actually turn around and say, well, religion, there is no such thing as religion. There's a whole bunch of different stuff which gets called religions, and there's a lot of differences between these things, and you cannot simplify it in terms of a single term. Right? So you already know that whatever I'm going to say is going to end up actually being pretty complex. Right? So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to start off by talking about some of the ways in which people usually think about this difference and what recent research tells us about these ways of thinking about it. Right? So very often, people will say, well, religion is fundamentally connected to morality and religious people are more moral than a-religious people. Right? Well, it so happens that there's a very recent meta-analysis done by Sharif. I'll be putting my references down here. Okay, so if anybody wants to grab the references, they'll be always down here on each page. Now, a meta-analysis takes a whole bunch of other studies and brings the results together and analyzes them statistically to see what the overall story is. Now, this meta-analysis was carried out on a bunch of studies which have very different methodologies. Now, the traditional way to study this question, what is the connection between morality and religiosity, was to sit people down in a room and to ask them a bunch of questions, such as, how often do you go to church? Oh, you go to church every week. Okay, thank you very much. And how much money do you give to charity? Oh, I see, you give all your money to charity, right? Okay, thank you very much. And guess what? Those kinds of pen and paper tests came out saying that there's a very strong connection between religiosity and prosociality or morality, or however you want to call it. Well, we now know there's a fundamental problem. Because you see, people who are likely to lie about how often they go to church are also likely to lie about how much they help others. And that seems to be a big part of the explanation of what was happening there. So these days, what's mostly used in this kind of area is what's known as dictator game. The dictator game is a very simple economic game which actually forces people to behave prosocially rather than just saying that they are being prosocial. What you do is you sit a person down in a room, you give them $10, for example, and say, look, here's your $10, you can walk out with that $10 right now, or you can give part of it to a stranger who will never know who gave him that money. In other words, they will give no money whatsoever. Right? In societies like Poland, What actually happens is that people actually usually do give some percentage of that money to the stranger. And you can vary the conditions, right? You can have a situation where you simply do it as I said you would do it, where you talk about it being without a prime, right? Without priming, in other words, without having a stimulus which is connected to something which is going to be important for the study. Or what you can do is you can have a religious prime. So for example, you can have somebody in the, you can have something in the background of the room. For example, you have a cross on the wall in the room, or you can ask them to do an exercise which includes words connected to religion. Or you could have a particular secular prime, where the secular prime is connected to things like the justice system, the police, or something like that, right? I'm staying at the hotel on the other side of the river, and there are lots of gentlemen in lovely uniforms staying there. That would be a nice secular prime for this kind of study. Right? And here's the interesting thing that was found. When you have no priming, people who say that they have very high religiosity, or all kinds of measures of religiosity, and people who say they have low religiosity behave much the same way. But if you put in the appropriate kind of religious prime, one that's relevant to the culture, right? The people who are religious end up giving a lot more in the dictator game. They behave more pro-socially, more morally, right? It's a simplification, but we'll go with that. But interestingly, in the kinds of societies that we live in, if you give the appropriate kind of secular prime, such as the gentleman in the uniform that I talked about before, everybody gives more. Everybody becomes more pro-social. Right? What's the conclusion to draw from that? Well, we have to think about it, but we see that the story is more complex than we originally thought. And we'll come back to this later, in a way. Okay, second thing that sometimes gets said is, well, you know, religious people are not particularly clever. Well, there's research on that. Again, a meta-analysis, references down here, right? Guess what? If you use different measures of intelligence and different measures of religiosity, you do get an anti-correlation. Right? So in other words, the more religious somebody is, the less intelligent they are likely to be. But it's a very weak anti-correlation. Right? It's less than 0.25. Sorry, that should be negative 0.25 because it's an anti-correlation, obviously, right? Now, guess what? That really is not very exciting. To give you an understanding of how very unexciting that is, I managed to find on the web an example of a study where they had that kind of level of correlation. So here's the graph for you guys. Right? There's actually a positive correlation there. But you can't tell from just looking at the picture that there is a definite positive correlation there. It's really difficult. Right? As I say, nothing to get excited about. And certainly, simply knowing that somebody is intelligent or not intelligent, or religious or not religious, doesn't tell you that much about the other of those two variables. Okay? So the fundamental story here is that the brains of people who are religious and people who are not religious, they're not that different. Of course, they're very often people who are religious and people who are scientists are actually the same people, right? In which case, they can't have different brains. All right, so another thing which often gets said is that, and this is a very, very much an enlightening kind of story, is that science has made religion obsolete. Well, again, there's a problem with that kind of story, because if you look at the worldwide patterns of secularization, and yes, of course, we are having secularization in various parts of the world, these patterns do not fit with that story. Right? The famous example, of course, is the example of the United States, and this is data from the Pew Global Attitudes Project. Right? The United States is a society which is very much scientifically advanced, and yet it's really quite religious, especially compared to other Western democracies. Right? So there's the question is, how important is religion to you? In the United States, 50% said it was very important, and in France, for example, they said 13% said that. Right? Very different figures, even though you have societies that are both scientifically advanced. So what's going on here? Well, we do have a theory. We do have some ideas. What appears to be the case is that secularization seems to be caused by what's known as existential security. To look at that in detail, look at the second reference there, the book by Norris and Inglehart. What does existential security mean here? Means basically being feeling safe about what's going to happen in your life, right? So for example, you get sick, and you're, okay, what's going to happen to me? Well, you're going to go to the hospital, and they'll take care of you. And you won't have to pay for it, right? You won't have to pay for it in France, in Britain, in Germany, in Spain. You will in the United States, right? I will lose my job. Will my kids go hungry? They won't. If you live in France, or Britain, or Germany, or Spain, but they will if you live in the United States. Okay? Now, there's a lot to be said here about that story. There's a lot of causal connections going on here that I could talk about. But the fundamental story, it seems to be, that it isn't science which makes religion obsolete. That at the societal level, and of course we are talking about the societal level here, we're not talking about the individual level. Because the individual level is a lot more complex, right? But at the societal level, what makes religion obsolete is the welfare state, because that is what gives people existential security. Okay? And it is these societies where you do have a strong welfare state that you do see secularization happening, and has been happening for many, many decades in some of them. Okay? Now, the idea that science makes religion obsolete is an attractive idea, but it's really based on a pretty fundamental misunderstanding of the role that beliefs play in science and religion, right? The idea is that science makes religion obsolete because it gives us a better explanation of what the world is like. And that is, as I say, based on a misunderstanding of what the role of beliefs is in science and religion. So let's look at that as the fourth thing. Right? Example from creationism, which is the usual thing that gets talked about in this conference. Right? So let's start off, first of all, by saying very clearly that, yes, scientific and religious beliefs are typically in conflict. Right? I'm not saying that these things are not in conflict. I'm saying that this conflict is not where the main story is happening. Okay? The reason is that beliefs are not central either to science or to religion. Now, most people in this room are likely to have experienced Catholicism or some other version of Christianity as the religion they know. But Christianity is really, really unusual. Most religions out there is a bunch of guys in some village making sacrifices to their ancestral spirits in order that their next hunt goes well. Okay? Most religions are very small scale and very different from Christianity. Of course, the question is, why has Christianity become so popular around the world? And that's an interesting question to ask, but it's a different question, right? But I pressed the wrong button. I knew I'd do that sooner or later. Okay. So here's the thing. In most religions, it is the practices that are central, not the beliefs. Okay? What matters is whether you participate in the rituals. not what you believe about these ancestral spirits, for example. Indeed. Okay? In fact, Christianity is not so unusual. Right? Of course, there's a lot about what official church dogma is and so on and so forth. But when you look at the data, it's actually not that Christians necessarily have a good grasp of what the official church doctrine is. Right? This is a famous example from another Pew study, the US Religious Knowledge Survey. The question was, I imagine that a lot of you know this one, the question was, the Eucharist for Catholics, does it that represent, is it a symbol of the body and blood of the Christ, or is it actually the body and blood of the Christ? Of Christ, sorry. Right? Now, the correct answer is that it is supposed to be the actual blood and body of Christ, not a symbol. And you could ask different groups, religious groups, that question, and if you ask the question of Catholics, as the question was asked, 55% said blood and body, which is the correct answer. 41% said it's a symbol. So somebody goes, okay, so at least 55% got it right. Well, it's an either or question, right? So 50% would be random. It was 5% over random. That really is not very impressive. Okay? And yet these people are very much Catholics. They identify as Catholics, they're part of the Catholic Church, etc., etc., etc. So obviously the fact that they get these kinds of really fundamental questions wrong, they just don't know, right? 4% were being honest and said, no idea, right? That's not a problem. So obviously, even in the case of Catholicism, beliefs are not actually as central as one would think they are. And if you think about it, the same goes for science. Right? You're not being a scientist because you believe in evolution, or even can explain what evolution is. That's not what science is about. But science is very much about belief change. Right? If you are given the right kind of evidence, you change your beliefs. Right? Otherwise, you know, beliefs I would identify being a scientist with? The ones that are in agreement with science today, the ones that are in agreement with science in 10 years? Right? That's not what the fundamental thing about science is. So let's not think about the difference between religion and science as being fundamentally about beliefs. It's not. There is a difference there, they do conflict, but that's not where the heart of the story lies. Okay? Okay, so what are we trying to do here? Well, the important thing is that if you're doing cognitive science of religion or cognitive science of science, you're trying to look at both of these things as natural phenomena. Right? There is this animal species, Homo sapiens. And what they do sometimes is build cathedrals. You know, ants build anthills, humans build cathedrals. They also build scientific institutes. What the hell do these animals do in those two different places? And why is it that the same kind of animal, the same basic kind of brain, engages in these two quite different kinds of activities, right? So as I said, same is cognitive system. The brains of religious people and the brains of scientists are not fundamentally different. Pretty much the same brains. And yet you've got different kinds of beliefs, different kinds of behaviors, and what's really essential, different kinds of social organization going on here, right? Because what I'm saying is that it is the different kinds of social organization that get the human cognitive system to produce different results under these different conditions. Right? So we're trying to identify the main underlying differences. Alright, so let's try and do some of that. I'm going to start off by talking about something which is really fundamental when it comes to understanding human society, which is, which is large-scale cooperation. For any social animal, cooperation is vital. Right? You don't get social animals if you don't have cooperation. It's pretty much the same thing. Right? So, in most cases, of most social animals, you can get an explanation of why they cooperate looking at such things as kin selection, looking at mutual altruism. Right? But the problem is that these kinds of explanations really only work in relatively small-scale societies when it comes to humans. Right? With ants, for example, you can get a very large anthill with lots of ants, and you get kin selection because they're all very closely related to each other. Humans don't do that, so that's not going to work for humans. But we have very large-scale societies. So how the hell did humans manage to get large-scale cooperation going? Right? And that has been a big question for people who have studied these kinds of things. What has been suggested, and I'm talking about here the work of Lorenz, his book, Big Gods, describing that, what has been suggested is that we've got the idea of supernatural punishment as a kind of solution for all that. Now, everybody here knows that people behave much more poorly on the internet than they do face to face. It's because they don't feel like they're being really monitored. Right? So they feel a lot freer to behave in much worse ways. So the idea behind supernatural punishment, there's lots of independent lines of evidence that it does work this way, is that if people think that there is an all-seeing, all-knowing, all-good being which is watching them and judging them and capable of punishing them for doing the wrong thing, they will behave in better ways than if they do not have that belief happening in their head. Right? And remember the thing we did with the dictator game? How people who are reminded of religion and are religious behave in better ways, right? That's the part of the explanatory story there. Now, as I say, lots of lines of evidence for this. My favorite is a very simple, I'll talk about the essential security in a second, it's a very simple study done by Bateson. That I'll quickly explain. Right? What they did is they had, in the departmental coffee room, they had a little jar where you put money in if you had coffee, to buy coffee for the next week, for the next month, or whatever, right? And all they did, the only manipulation they did, was that at the top of the piece of paper saying, please put some money in here if you're having a coffee, they, 1 week, they had pictures of flowers, and the next week, they had pictures of eyes. And you can see what the effect was, right? People gave more money if on the piece of paper there were eyes. Now, obviously, nobody thought they were actually being monitored, right? If you look at a picture, you don't actually think that you're being monitored. It's a subconscious thing, right? You feel monitored. And you behave more prosocial. And this result has been repeated in all kinds of different ways, right? It's very solid stuff. Obviously, this doesn't talk about supernatural punishment, supernatural monitoring, but it goes towards that. Right, so it fits with existential security also because in the case of existential security, what you have is secular societies actually managing to create a situation where people have the motivation to behave prosocially without the need for these supernatural punishment ideas. Right? Okay. Now here's the important thing. Here's the really key thing. Big gods, right? This is what Lorenz calls these gods who monitor and can punish you. They don't have to be real, right? There doesn't have to be a god out there who will actually punish you for doing this, for you to behave in a better way. All that's necessary is that you believe that there is such a God who will do this, right? So this is the vital thing when it comes to religious beliefs. Their function, in this case, to motivate pro-social behavior is not connected to the truth. And this is very unusual. In the case of most beliefs, their function is connected to their accuracy, to the truth, right? If I want to know if somebody tells me where to find the coffee shop and they tell me incorrect information, that's useless to me. They have to give me the correct information for that to be useful. Right? And that's typical. It's certainly the case with scientific beliefs. Right? In the case of religious beliefs, the truth is not connected to their function. So the functionality is non-aletheic. And that's absolutely fundamental, right? All they have to be is plausible and memorable, and also, in effect, hard to investigate. Why do they have to be hard to investigate? Because in the case of religious beliefs, from a pragmatic point of view, you do not want them to be chosen on the basis of their accuracy, because their accuracy is not connected to the functionality. It's irrelevant. You could just as well choose them on the basis of whether you can see them. It's irrelevant. Okay? So, in terms of what it means for them to be plausible and memorable, people normally talk about them in terms of being minimally counterintuitive. Right? This is from Boyer's work. What it means is that basically they're in line with human expectations, right? If you think about most gods, most of what we know about them, we know because it fits in with what we normally expect of these kinds of beings, like human beings, right? This picture of Ganesha. Thank you. Yes, I was going to say Garuda, but Garuda is a different deity. Ganesha. Yes. He's got a head of an elephant and four arms rather than two, but other than that, he behaves like you expect a human being to behave. You know, he has desires, he has ideas, he acts in particular ways which is connected to the desires and the beliefs, etc., 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 right? So they generally fit with expectations except for one or two traits which really do not fit. They just break out of the mold, which means that these ideas become very, very memorable, right? Somebody tells you, oh, I saw a guy walking down the street and, you know, he wasn't doing anything particular. You forget that. Somebody tells you, oh, I saw a guy walking down the street, he had the head of an elephant. Okay, yeah, you'll remember that, right? So, you know, other examples, werewolves. They're essentially humans in many ways, but they're in animal bodies. Or ghosts, which are humans, but they don't have bodies. Right? These are all things that are going to be plausible because they fit with our general expectations, but at the same time, highly memorable. And the thing is that scientific ideas are actually very different. They're maximally counterintuitive. They go counter to expectations in hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different ways. Right? Macaulay has a lovely book on that, right? And they have to be hard to investigate, right? The content has to be hard to investigate itself. So, you know, if you have a supernatural belief, it makes much more sense to have a supernatural belief in nasty forest spirits that are hard to see, and then if you go looking for them, they will cause trouble for you. Because who's going to do that, right? Rather than in very friendly ghosts that come into the village every day, talk to your friends, sit down, have coffee with you. What? Nobody's going to believe that because that just doesn't happen. Right? So they have to come to investigate. Vague, you know, that comes distant, dangerous. Also, it's very useful if the investigation of these kinds of beliefs is socially hindered. And here, the notion of the sacred, which many scholars of religion see as central to religion, is great, right? Think about it. If an item is sacred, if it is to be set aside from the normal flow of things in society, that makes it more difficult for it to be studied. Right? There's a picture of the Shroud of Turin. For a very long time, it was too sacred for it to be studied scientifically. And then it was decided, well, actually, we can take a piece of the Shroud of Turin and check what age it is. It's medieval. Right? And finally, the tools for investigation also have to be hindered. So if you develop novel ways of investigating these claims, that also creates a problem for these kinds of beliefs. And of course, the exact opposite is true of science, right? If you think about it in detail, don't have the time to go into it. But the point is, this makes perfect sense given how very different the functions of religion and science are. Right? Given that function of religion is non-leafing, not connected to the truth of these beliefs, that's exactly what religion should be doing. Right? Alright. So, I don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to go fairly quickly through the rest of it. But the basic story is, right? Christianity, Catholicism, is an example of a big God religion. And these are the ones that are, you know, large-scale religions also, in general. Right? So they talk about beings that are morally engaged, that are capable of monitoring us in some way, that are capable of punishing and rewarding us, that are minimally counterintuitive, so generally in line with our expectations, but there's one or two things which really make them stand out. Like it's like a meal. But at the same time, claims regarding them have to be hard to investigate. Society has to be structured in such a way as to discourage investigating them. And the thing is, this isn't a conspiracy. It's selection, right? The religions that were not like that were not successful, right? We don't need to talk about there being conspiracy to create a religion like that. No, these are simply the ones that were successful because they had these traits, ones that fit very nicely with what our communist system is like, what our social organization is like. The fundamental thing, as I said, the function is not connected to their truth, which explains half of what I said above. Okay, now, I have another whole section here about social learning, which is all really cool, but 19 seconds will not cut it. So, I'm going to fly through that. I kind of figured this would happen, that's why I didn't organize it this way. So I'll just get to the conclusions, okay? Right, so science and religion apply the same basic cognitive human, the same basic human cognitive abilities, but to very different ends. Okay, and that helps to understand us why they are so different. The ends are different. Right, the fundamental thing being that in the case of religions, their function is non-leafing. Religion doesn't have to be true for it to have the desirable social consequences, that it promotes pro-social behaviors, right? Now, what this means, well, it doesn't mean that religion doesn't tell us anything about the world around us. It does. It tells us about a particular piece of the world. It tells us a hell of a lot about what our minds are like, what our cognitive system is like, right? Because that's what it ends up reflecting. Because it is so organized to avoid counter evidence, so that evidence doesn't come into the picture so much. Okay? And it is very much suited to its function, and not because of some kind of a underhanded plan, but as I said, because of selection. It's the ones that suited that function that come around. Science has a different function, we know that, and that's why that behaves in very different ways. It's organized in different ways. It's organized to motivate people, right, to examine claims critically, because that's what it's about. And in its case, the truth of the beliefs that it generates, that it stabilizes, is vital. Okay. Thank you very much.